people's thinking about tax, and actually I don't have any problem with that whatsoever. I think this. Well, anyway, but I think what we live in a society where tax has become a dirty word. I mean, I remember when I was growing up, in the 1950s in Glasgow, my mother was a home help, my father was a labourer, in the sense, and they didn't earn very much money, but they were paying the basic rate of income tax at 33 pence a pound, and nobody said a word. Because we're getting the National Health Service for the first time in our lives, the family's lives, we're getting free education. And we're getting, you know, all the things of welfare state that never existed before. People could see a connection between tax and the good things in life, but they seem to have lost track of it. And somehow we've got to find our way back to that kind of thinking, to make people think that tax isn't a bad thing. The Americans started this by using words, loaded words, about tax relief and all this kind of thing, as if tax was a burden placed upon people. Tax is what makes societies tick. It's a good thing, and we've got to find a way back into persuading people that that's the case. And the easiest way to start with is taxing the rich, because most people who are rich are quite happy to see other people taxed for themselves. But I also don't think that they know that there's any need to fear a one-party state. I'm not convinced even that the SNP will be the biggest beneficiaries of an independent Scotland. I'm not convinced that a Scottish Labour Party that was rooted in the trade union movement and was free of London and free of England would not be the biggest beneficiaries of an independent Scotland. They can't see it themselves. But I'm not convinced that they would be the biggest party in Scotland after independence. And in any case, I also don't think that... I kind of missed the point I was going to make.
Do you want to answer the question the lady asked about how you were missing Melbourne and you get 16 and 17
years old? You talk to them, I mean, give them ideas and they'll hear them. I'm a member of the General Municipal and Boilermakers Union. I've never seen a boilermaker in my life. But my member of the GMB, when I joined the SSP and this campaign started, the GMB phoned me up and said, will you come and make the case for independence at the GMB? I said, yeah, sure. And I walked along and it was a trap. They packed the meeting full of their MPs and their MSPs, all Labour Party activists and supporters there just to give me a hammer, basically. You know? And at the end of it, I got a hammer for most of the meeting. But at the end of it, a number of them walked up and said, we've never heard the arguments before. Thanks. It's making us think differently, because they just haven't heard the arguments. They don't know what the arguments are. All they hear is the propaganda from one side, which they say, I voted Labour, I listen to what Labour MPs tell me. I don't listen to anybody else. But I think in this campaign, I've got the opportunity to get across to people who don't normally hear these arguments and do it. I don't know the social media. I'm not the best person placed to talk to young people. Remember when I first got elected as an MSP, I was 50. Donald Jill didn't know quite what to do with me. He was one of the few MPs that was in the first parliamentary Labour group in Holyrood. So he made me the youth spokesperson at the age of 50. And then did he let me speak at any of the conferences. I was standing in the conference with my hand up to speak to the youth debate and they wouldn't even call me. It was just a tight note. But young people will listen. And what the National Pensions Convention are doing, for example, they hold a big demonstration every autumn in London at the Westminster Parliament. And this year they're doing it across the age divide. They're doing it with all the young people's organisations, the Pensions Convention coming together, and they're planning a joint demonstration where they listen to each other, what the problems of each group is, and try to work together, because it's the same problem at the end of the day. And I think that's how you actually get to young people. Young people have only been treated differently from the other groups of society. They've been treated worse in many respects. But the same bad things are happening to other age groups as well. And the last thing that we need to allow to happen is for an age gap to open up. You know, where older people don't like younger people, and younger people blame older people for the problems they've got. We can't allow that to happen. It's a class issue. And it's right across the whole age group that the same things are happening. The only way we can defeat it is by coming together as one. And the final point I'll make is this. It's no our place to worry about Tory governments getting elected and the rest of the UK if Scotland becomes independent. Scotland's got 5 million people. The rest of the UK's got 60 million. They can't hold us responsible if they elect a Tory government after we've gone. What they could do after we've gone is adopt a proportional representation system of election, and they'll never have a Tory government in the rest of the UK again, just as we'll never have a Tory government in independent Scotland again. It's as simple as that. What's happening at the moment is that Labour and the Tories are hand in glove with each other. They've got a monopoly on political power in the Parliament under the first-past-post system, which guarantees if it's not the Tories, it's Labour, and if it's not Labour, it's the Tories. And they like it, and they don't want to change it. And it's time to learn down south that we're going to have to change it, because we've had it up to here. We've had election after election and we've voted the Tories out of power and got Tory government stuffed down our throats. And it's time to say, no more. We decide for ourselves who we're governing. No depending on other people telling us who will reign over us and govern over us in this country. So it's very simple. It's for the good of everybody if Scotland goes independent, and especially for the workers down there, because then they may get up off their knees and start to do things to make sure that they never get a Tory government themselves, just like they do in Scotland as well. So let's go, we can all look forward to a much, much fairer, a much more equal and a much better society to live in, not just in Scotland, but right across the whole of these islands. And that's the prize that we should all try to fight for in this election. So